In this video, we're going to be covering the basics of geometry. And what I mean by basics are the building blocks of geometry. But more importantly, in order to be able to read and write notation, we have to sort of put all of this together at one time. So just keep in mind that this video is going to cover a lot of little nitty-gritty material, but these concepts are going to be reoccurring throughout the entire year. Now we're going to go about this by using the graphic organizer that you got in class. All right, and we're going to break this up into three sections: what we see on the page, what we write for notation, and how we say it when we read it out loud. Working a little bit out of order, the first thing we have, the smallest building block in geometry we have, is a point. And so you might see a little dot on a page and a letter next to that, and it should be uppercase. We are case sensitive in this course. We're going to say, when we see this point and a letter next to it, we'll say point P, or if this were an A, we'd say point A. And if we wanted to reference it on a note or a homework assignment, we would use the capital letter P. Again, we are case sensitive in this course. Moving right along, if you put a whole bunch of points in a collinear fashion, and I'll deal with collinear in a bit, you'll end up with a line. A line is always straight, so you don't have to say straight line because there's no other flavor other than straight. A line will have arrows on both ends and extends in two directions, and it will be labeled with a series of capital points. Now, there might be another point in here, and maybe that letter right there is M. You can pick any two points. Okay, any two points names the line. I happen to choose D and B. Now, generally, students choose the two points on the end. So I write the letters capital D and B in either order. And then I put a little mini line over those letters with little arrows on both sides to indicate that we're referring to a line. Now, even though this picture is small, I mean, we could really have, you know, a big line over this with a lot of dots, right? And I could go A, B, C, and D. I could call this line AD. I could call this line BD. I could call this line DC. What's critical is that I'm picking two points that are on said line in any order, and they're capitalized, and I have the little arrows on the end, okay? Now that we got that mess cleaned out of the way, we'll go on to what we read. We're going to read this as line DB. So if you were to see something like this structure in a sentence or in instructions, you would say line DB because I see the line above it. The next thing we're going to have here is a plane. Now, for now, what I want you to do is think of a plane as a flat surface, maybe perhaps like the ceiling or the wall, flat piece of paper, the cover of a book, just the flat surface itself. And what we're going to need to name a plane is three letters. Let me correct myself there for a second. Not necessarily three letters, but three points. And the points are going to be categorized by a letter. Okay. So on this plane here, I happen to have four different points. And those four points are labeled with capital letters M, A, T, H. Now, all I need to do is pick out any three, right? Any three letters names a plane. So I chose the letters T, A, and H. It doesn't matter the order, as long as I get three capital letters, and then over the top, I'm going to have that arrowed line piece. Now you say, hang on a second, wasn't this the symbol for line? Well, it's a symbol for a line when it's above two capital letters. It's a symbol for a plane when it's above three capital letters. What arrows denote in mathematics, and it's very important across all mathematics, if you see arrows on the end of something, what we're saying is, hey, this picture doesn't stop here, it continues on forever. And that flat surface is a hypothetical space that extends in all directions forever. When we see it, we're just going to simply say the words plane followed by the letters T-A-H. At this point, you want to make sure that you press pause and you have all of the notation that's here. And I would also encourage you to copy that into your notes to remind you that, yes, this is a case-sensitive course. So press pause now. Continuing on the thought process of what we see, what we write, and what we read, we move on to a line segment. Now, right here, I have a line segment drawn, and the endpoints are in red. Now what I've done is I've added in a few other points in here, and I've actually even color-coded them black. And the reason why is I want to focus on the endpoints. You must use endpoints when naming a segment. And a segment is probably going to be one of the most common building blocks of geometry that we reference throughout the year. So it's important to pay attention to this one. Even if I had a capital letter notation here for all of these points, I would only use them if I wanted to name like this little piece of the segment right here, then I would need these two letters. But when I want to reference this whole piece all the way from D all the way to S, I'm going to name this as such. I'm going to use a little segment bar notation. Notice the absence of arrows and DS. I can also label it SD, but I think it's sort of common to write from left to right, so I'm just going to leave it like that. Again, why do I leave the arrows off? No arrows on this because this segment doesn't go on forever. It does have a beginning and an ending point, right? It's terminal. So we make sure that we include that in the notation. And what are we going to say? Well, of course, you guessed it. Segment DS. So when I read this, I say this. Next, we're going to move on to array. And what array is it sort of takes on the components of both the line segment and a line. It has a starting point, right? And it heads in one direction. And it goes on, you guessed it, forever because we see that arrow. So this is the first one of the series where all of a sudden now order matters. Okay? Order matters when naming array. That first letter, when we name this thing, is going to be its starting point. So no matter what, this ray has to start with the letter R. The second letter, and we're going to only use two letters, the second letter is going to be a letter of your choosing. And all it has to do is be one of the letters in the direction that the ray is heading. So RA or RY. Again, I think that most students go with the furthest letter. You don't have to. You could call this RY. And excuse me, not RY, but Ray RY, or you can call it Ray RA. As long as this first letter is the starting point of the ray, or we really refer to it as an endpoint, but that sounds kind of weird. It starts here, it goes in this direction. So as long as you choose that starting point, that endpoint, R, has to be the first letter because order matters, and then the second letter of your choosing in the direction that the ray heads. So R to Y suits us just fine. R to A suits us just fine. Both of these names, although the letters are different, refer to the exact same ray. And we're going to say Ray RY or Ray RA. Notice if you go back to all of these items, we say segment to indicate that we're looking at a segment. We say ray to indicate that we're looking at a ray. We don't just read it as DS and RA. We say the notation that comes above the letters first and then the letters. Next we have angle. Now if you take a look closely, I did my best to be corny and put the word algebra in here, but we have 5 points on this angle. Most importantly, the point that catches my attention first is G. G is going to be the vertex of that angle. Identifying the vertex of an angle, this guy right here, is going to be the most important thing in naming the angle. We're going to name this angle using 3 letters sometimes and 1 letter sometimes. I can use 1 letter if there's no ambiguity, right? I don't confuse the angle with another angle. And by that I mean, take a picture that looks like this. Well, there's 1, 2, 3, 4 basic angles here. There's some others, but if I just had a point and I had the vertex right here, that's the vertex of all four angles. Well, I couldn't just call that, you know, if that letter was angle G, I couldn't say angle G because you wouldn't know who I was talking about. I would need to use some other letters to make sure that you knew I was referencing angle 1, for instance. On this particular angle that I have drawn, there is no confusion about what angle I'm talking about. So I could use one letter, and then I simply just put the notation in front of it like this, and that's going to be angle G. What about the three-lettered version? The three-lettered version, as you see, has three letters, duh, and the middle letter is going to include the vertex every time. That middle letter must be the vertex, which is why we want to identify the vertex. So again, if there's no confusion, it's just one angle, we could just call it by the vertex letter, capital, with a little angle notation in the front, and we would say angle G. Or we have a three-lettered version, and G, our vertex is going to be the center angle, or I'm sorry, the central letter, and then the two letters on either side in caps are going to be any letter from one side and any letter from the other side. Now, just on a side note, take notice, what is an angle? It's two rays. So really, we have ray GB or ray GE and ray GA or ray GL. And when I have the same, when they share a common endpoint, they become an angle. So what we're going to do is we're just going to pick a letter from each ray. I chose B from the top one and L from the bottom one. It doesn't matter as long as you pick one from each side. And then I'm just going to name that saying those letters in that order. Angle BGL, angle BGL. I could call this angle EGA. I could call it angle EGL. I could call it angle BGA. So you'll see now that there's going to be lots of good answers, lots of good things. So never be afraid to ask or clarify notation questions in class. It's going to be very important. Our last two words are going to describe relationships. So the first handful of things were actual pieces or building blocks of geometry. These last few are relationships. So our first relationship is going to be when things are identical, and we use the word congruent. We see this symbol, it's an equal sign with a little tilde across the top, not to be confused with similar, which is just the double tilde. Another way to think about similar is approximately, but I'm getting ahead of myself. If we take a look at this picture down here, we see two identical triangles. Now, triangles are made up of three sides, right? Three segments and three angles. And you'll notice that we have all these little tick marks or hash marks. So I take a look right here, I see this segment BC, and again, just to refresh, right, we're thinking about segment BC, capital letter, and then I see over here segment FE on the other triangle, FE, and what do I notice about those two things? I notice that they both have a single tick mark, which means that these two segments are identical, or more importantly, those two segments are congruent. So we could write the following. Segment BC, right? Segment BC is congruent to segment FE, right? So again, when I see this symbol, I say is congruent to, right? We read is congruent to. Again, in the picture, if you take a look, we have angle C and angle F, both shaded in purple. We got that arc here, two tick marks. Ah, they match up. They're identical size. So angle C is congruent to angle F. Angle C is congruent to angle F. So all of this writing right here can be condensed down to just a nice little bit of notation like that. So it's really concise. Now let's move on to similar. And again, just a reminder, as you watch videos, you'll notice that I throw a bunch of stuff on the screen here. I got all this stuff that I sort of did behind the scenes. So if you want to press pause and add that to your notes, or wait until I talk through it and then decide what you want to add to your notes. But everything that I write, you should be writing. Now back to similarity. Think about it as same shape but different size. So we have this double tilde piece. And so when you look down here, I have these two pentagons, and one is bigger than the other, but they're very similar, right? They're not identical, but they are the same shape, just different size. Now, you should understand that in similarity, angles are congruent. So angle B here, this vertex right here, is the same as angle R, right? Exactly the same. So we're going to say angle B is congruent to angle R. That's congruency. But when we name the pentagon, we just name the five letters and we start at any point and then work our way around in a clockwise fashion. And then you want to start in the same spot on the other one and work around in a clockwise fashion. So we're going to say that A, B, C, D, E, that's how you name a polygon. You name all of its vertices, plural for vertex. A, B, C, D, E is similar to QRSTV. So just once again, we're going to say that A, B, C, D, E is similar to QRSTV. So by using notation, by using the similarity notation, I didn't want to put it up here. The yellow kind of doesn't really stand out that great. By using this notation, we're allowed to ditch is similar to the words and just put in the symbol. And that's it. It's a lot of stuff, but these are the basics that we're going to use all year. So you want to be sure to practice these things. So just to recap in rapid fire succession, the six main building blocks were point, right? And we would just use the capital letter G to reference that. We have a line, so we would pick any two letters and put the line notation. So I'm just going to choose line AB. For the segment, remember, we got to use the endpoints, so segment AC with the segment bar over the top. The ray has to be, the first letter has to be the beginning spot and then any direction it's heading, so ray FO. I got the fox there for the racers in the group. And this should be an arrow. Sorry about that. So that's going to be ray FO. On the angle, we could call this angle O because there's no ambiguity. Or we could call this angle PON. Remember that that middle letter must be the vertex. And then the other two letters come from either side of the angle. So one of these two and one of these two. And then lastly, but not leastly, we have our plane. Any three letters from this plane will do. So how about B, C, X with the line notation over the above that indicates that this flat surface sort of extends in all directions. And then, of course, we have the similar and congruency. All right. That should be enough to get you going.